سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. وبعده. Again, so with the life of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and again, just to emphasize the importance of learning about the life, the details of the life of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, that it is such a fundamental and important element in our identity as a Muslim. It's a very important element in how we see ourselves as Muslim, because that's our history. And part of how we construct our identity as human beings is that we build it on a historical background. We have to have a historical background. Jazakallah khair. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our Islamic identity is such a fundamental figure, such an essential, central figure. So his life is not just like the life of anyone else, it's the real manifestation of what Islam means. Like Aisha radiallahu anha was asked about khuluq al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She was asked about the manners of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about the demeanor of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How did he carry himself? How was he as a man? She gave one word to summarize who the Prophet ﷺ was as a person. She said, كان خلقه القرآن. His demeanor was the Qur'an. So he was a Qur'an manifested in human reality. So you want to understand the Qur'an, you want to implement the Qur'an, you have to understand the example of the Prophet ﷺ. His life, his demeanor, his character. That's it. His life is just a practical human manifestation of what the Qur'an really teaches. And this is one of the wisdoms of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when he shows the truth to us, Allah has given us the truth through so many routes. One of them is the fitrah. Allah has planted the seed of the truth in our very makeup, in who we are. So we humans are designed based on Islam. We human beings are designed naturally based on Islam. So that's the first route to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the first route to the truth. Another route of the truth is the Quran itself. The revelation in words. The truth in the words, the divine words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another way to, or another route to the truth, to the same truth, no difference, to the same truth, is the sunnah and the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It shows us in human terms and human form what it means to be a Muslim, what Islam, how Islam manifests as a human reality. So this is why it's important for us to look into the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as we study it, we don't want to see it as a distant history that we're just looking at through the lens of 1400 years. No, it is a human life that we can connect to, that we can relate to, and we'll try to bring it to life as much as possible. So we reached the point where the Prophet ﷺ was in his late 30s, and he ﷺ started to feel strange things. He started to see things he's not used to. So he sees lights, he hears sounds, things he's not used to, and this confuses him. So the person that he returns to, he refers to, whenever he is troubled, was his wife. And thus we said, this is a very strong indicator about the importance of having a good spouse. A good spouse. So a good spouse is a good friend, is a companion. That's your companion in your journey to Allah. That's your companion. Your spouse is not supposed to be a burden. It's not supposed to be a distraction. It is supposed to be your companion on this way that leads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's supposed to be the best aid. Khadija radiallahu anha was that person for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when he was troubled, the first person he thinks about going to and sharing that these feelings and this confusion with was his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. And this speaks volumes about the relationship between the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his wife Khadija. Without having to have direct narrations, the Prophet ﷺ treated Khadija like this, he spoke to her like this, she spoke to him like that. We don't need this. The fact that when he is troubled, the first person he thinks of is his wife Khadija, that speaks volumes of what she meant to him and how she treated him. So that shows trust, that shows no judgment. There are spouses that are afraid to go back to their husband or to their wife when they are in trouble because they realize they're just going to make it harder for them. Or they're going to judge them. Or they will have evil suspicion and sort of run about them. And they will not really help them, they'll just make things more complicated. But looking at the example of the Prophet ﷺ, and this is, by the way, one of the most important aspects of people who achieve something in their life. Usually people who achieve something in their life, they have a good spouse behind them, or a horrible spouse behind them. A horrible spouse behind them, because some of the most famous, it's a minority among the famous people and super achievers throughout the human history, were actually people who achieved a lot because they were tormented at home. They had no life at home. What's the famous Russian story writer? The most famous, Tolstoy. Tolstoy, people who wrote about his biography, they said the reason for his genius, for his abundance in terms of writing, he was a prolific story writer, he wrote so many stories. The reason and the genius in his writings actually comes from his suffering with his wife. Really? Probably Stoyevsky? Okay. So I thought it was Tolstoy. Anyway. A good wife. Okay. So anyway, it applies to the rule. Either this or that. Either this or that. So, and I think Tolstoy had a story, The Death of a Salesperson. And it was basically someone who really suffered a very bad life. And his wife was a very bad wife. So he was on his deathbed, so he was dying. And he said a profound statement, really it gets you to think. Really gets you, and it shows you that the fitrah really is there, even with those non-Muslims, people not really informed by revelation, still you can see the elements of fitrah are creeping in and it's pushing against all of these clouds of doubts and ignorance. The fitrah still pushes there. So he wrote the story, one of his most famous stories, The Death of a Salesperson. And at the end of this salesperson's life, his life was miserable, was all miserable. So he was on his deathbed and he was very depressed at that moment. And his wife was next to him. Then he turns to his wife and he says to her, and that was his last statement before he takes his last breath, then he dies. He says, "What if my whole life has been wrong? What if my whole life has been wrong?" A profound question. A profound question. And that shows that, subhanAllah, the fitrah is still there. Anyway, so the Prophet ﷺ had a wife like no other. Like no other. So whenever he was troubled, he would refer to her and he would share his concerns with her. And obviously, she was the best. She was the best. Because some people, when you share your concern with them, they make you feel even worse. They either disengage from you, they don't want anything to do with you, so they detach, or they make you feel even worse by feeling more pity, make you feel more of a victim. But a wise person would give you a perspective. Sometimes without saying any word, just saying, "Oh, it's all right. It's okay." Sometimes that's all you need to hear. But the person has to be composed themselves. They have to have this composure and this trust and this balance about them. So Khadija radiallahu anha, also being older than the Prophet ﷺ, a woman with a lot of experience, she was that type of wise woman. When the Prophet ﷺ came to her and he said, "I'm seeing strange things, I can hear sounds," she says, "Don't worry, someone like you, nothing wrong could go with you. Allah will not let you down. There must be something good happening to you. So take it easy, it's okay." As in our everyday language, it's okay. Don't worry, everything will just be all right. As simple as that. And then, as I said, the Prophet ﷺ started to see strange things. For example, he says, And this hadith is in Sahih, in the Sahih. He says, إِنِّي لَأَعْرِفُ حَجَرًا بِمَكَّةَ كَانَ يُسَلِّمُ عَلَيَّ قَبْلَ الْبِعْثَةِ. I know a stone in Mecca that used to give me salam before I received revelation. Every time the Prophet ﷺ passed by that stone, it would say, Salamu alaykum ya Muhammad. It's weird, scary, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing him for receiving the message, because he's gonna have such an experience. So this is why we said the Prophet ﷺ had the habit or the practice of going to Ghar Hira on top of the mountain. Who's ever been there to that place? Who's ever climbed that mountain? Okay, so you've seen it's now Mecca has extended, it's right at the bottom of the mountain. You can find houses, but at that time it was distant. Mecca was still small, so it was distant from the mountain. So the Prophet ﷺ would stay there for a month, not the whole month, basically for a few days, then he would go back home and get some food and provisions and then go back again, and this process would take a month. So that's what the Prophet ﷺ used to do. And one year when he was 40, the Prophet ﷺ was there in Ghar Hira. And then a new encounter, something happens for the first time in his life. He says, Jibreel comes to him. He says, Al-Malak, it was Jibreel alayhi salam. He comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there is a narration. This narration is in Sahih, Sahih Bukhari and Muslim. But there is another narration that's in Sirat ibn Maghazi ibn Ishaq, okay, the main book on the Sirah, and the chain of narration is acceptable. It says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a dream before that, because one of the signs he started to see lately was every dream he had, it would turn into a reality the following day. It would turn into a reality the following day. So that was surprising to him. Every dream he had, he wakes up next morning, and then he sees it happening in front of his eyes. So the narration in Maghazi ibn Ishaq, it says the Prophet ﷺ, he says, when I was sleeping in Ghar Hira, in the cave, Jibreel comes to me with a piece of cloth and he has a book in it. And he says to me, Iqra. I tell him, Ma ana biqari. I don't know how to read. The Prophet ﷺ was illiterate. He didn't learn how to read or write. The Arabs depended so much on memory. They depended so much on memory. They didn't document things by writing, but by memorizing them. And they had a bent for memorization. So they could memorize something upon hearing it once. Upon hearing something once, they would memorize it. And there was a lot of accounts from those times about some like mind-blowing stories about how they memorized things. So, for example, someone would hear or would listen to some poetry, let's say 100 lines, 200 lines. Upon hearing that the first time, they could repeat it. Once the poet finishes reciting his poetry, the listener would be able to repeat it from their memory. There's a lot of these. There's a lot of these. And by the way, until today, there are people who have this memory. There are people, some, but these are very exceptions now. But then, it was very common, specifically as we said, people depended heavily on their memory. So the Prophet ﷺ saw Jibreel in his sleep. And we know the Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith, رؤيا الأنبياء حق. رؤيا الأنبياء حق. The dreams of the prophets is revelation, it's truth. It's true revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the narration of Ibn Ishaq says Jibreel came to him in his dream holding a piece of cloth, and in the piece of cloth there was a book, and he says to him, Iqra. So I tell him, Ma ana biqara, I don't know how to read. So he holds him tight. Then he releases him and he says, Iqra. And I told him, Ma ana biqara, I don't know how to read. I don't read. So he says, so he held him a second time. Then a third time he said, Iqra. I said, I don't know how to read. He holds him again. Third time, then he releases him and he says, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. So in his dream, the Prophet ﷺ says, that moment out of fear, extreme fear, I wake up. I wake up and I run out of the cave. I went out of the cave. And then I look at the horizon and I see the angel Jibreel, as in the mission, فَأَرَى جِبْرِيلْ صَافًا قَدَمَيْهِ قَدْ مَلَأَ الْأُفُقِ. So I see Jibreel standing upright and he has blocked the whole horizon. So I turn away from him. Then I find him, wherever I turn, I see him in front of me. Then he says, يَا مُحَمَّدْ أَنْتَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَأَنَا جِبْرِيلْ. He says, oh Muhammad, you are the messenger of Allah and I am Jibreel. So this narration happens in Maghazi or the book of Ibn Ishaq. And the chain of narration is actually acceptable. But the real encounter, which seems to be the manifestation of this dream, is that the Prophet ﷺ was in the cave when Jibreel comes to him now face to face, in his wake, like he's not sleeping. So he comes to him and he says, اقرأ. The Prophet ﷺ says, ما أنا بقارئ. I don't know how to read. I just want you to imagine what kind of encounter that was for the Prophet ﷺ. It's something he's never seen before. It's an angel. It's an angel. And so he approaches the Prophet ﷺ. All of a sudden, the Prophet ﷺ is taken by surprise. اقرأ, he says to him, read. So he initiates a conversation with a command, with an imperative, read. مَا أَنَا بِقَارِئ, I don't know how to read. So he holds him tight. Imagine something you've never seen before, you've never done before, you don't know what it is, then it holds you so tight. The Prophet ﷺ says, until I could not even breathe, then he releases me. Then he says, اقرأ, and I say, مَا أَنَا بِقَارِئ, which means I do not know how to read. Or it could also mean what to read. What do you want me to read? He says, اقرأ, for the second time. So he holds him tight again until he says, I could no longer breathe, then he releases me. Then the third time he does that, then he says, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. These are the first words that Allah reveals. The first words of the Qur'an to be revealed, the first words of revelation. And always the first things to be revealed show so much significance. اقرأ, read. So that shows if you want guidance, you'll find it in reading, in knowledge. You will find it in knowledge, in learning. اقرأ. So the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in reading, is in learning, is in educating yourself. There's no other way. You can't make your way to Allah based on ignorance. You can't. This will lead you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because oftentimes we think about ignorance as simple lack of knowledge. We think, ignorance is I don't know. Simple lack of knowledge. Bismillah. Alhamdulillah. But the reality is, ignorance does not stay at that level of lack of knowledge. It builds into wrong knowledge, assumptions. If you do not know about something, automatically your mind will fill that void with assumptions, inaccurate assumptions. So you start building assumptions which are not true. These are conclusions that are baseless. Then they start building up, you start to have a body of knowledge that is detached from reality. And this will affect your perception. It will affect your perception. So you will think, I know, and because your mind is full with that low quality information, which is assumptions, which is baseless, so there's no place, there's no vacuum for you to absorb knowledge, so you start pushing it away. This is why Imam Ali radiallahu anhu, he says, من جهل شيئا عاداه. Someone who doesn't have knowledge about something, he will have enmity towards it. What type of ignorance he's talking about? Someone who's ignorant about something will have enmity towards it. What does that mean? That means when you don't have knowledge about something, you will develop assumptions, false knowledge.
And then when the true knowledge comes to you, it challenges what you know. It tells you what you know or what your assumptions are wrong. And then this is when your ego kicks in and you take it personal. No, I can't be mistaken and you're right. That's when you start to push against true knowledge. This is why ignorance is very dangerous. Because if we were to stay at the basic level of ignorance, perfect. No problem. I don't know. And I seek to learn. When knowledge comes, I'll be absorbent. That's the nature of human beings. But shaitan is not going to let you, you know, in that peaceful place. Shaitan will fill up your mind through his whispering with a lot of doubts, a lot of assumptions. What about this? What? Oh, maybe this is what that is. Or maybe this is what it means. Okay, I know what that is. Then you start to become more confident about your assumptions and you think, okay, I know it. So when someone comes and shares with you the true knowledge, oh no, that goes against what I know. It must be wrong, it doesn't make sense to me. Because you have already built. And what we call this in Arabic is al-jahlul murakkab, complex ignorance. Because we have two types in Arabic, two types of ignorance. Two types of ignorance. There is simple ignorance, which we call ignorance, lack of knowledge, simple lack of knowledge. And complex ignorance, which in English you call assumptions or misinformation. That's what you call it in English. In Arabic, they call it complex ignorance. Is that you don't know, and you don't know that you don't know. You don't know, okay, that piece of information. That's one level of ignorance. A higher level of ignorance that makes it complex is you don't know that you don't know, but you think you know. And that's what the famous Arab linguist, Al-Khalil ibn Ahmad al-Farahidi, he's one of the Tabi'een. Al-Khalil ibn Ahmad al-Farahidi. That's a famous name. Khalil ibn Ahmad al-Farahidi. Anyone knows what he did, what his specialty was? You know the patterns of poetry, the rhythms of poetry in Arabic? They have 16. They have 17 actually. He figured out 16 out of them. He put the patterns for Arabic poetry. This is why he's very famous. And he was an excellent, one of the top linguists of his time. Al-Khalil ibn Ahmad al-Farahidi. He has a beautiful statement, a very famous statement. He says people are four types. الناس أربعة. رجل يعلم أنه رجل يعلم ويعلم أنه يعلم ذلك عالم فاتبعوه. People are four. A person who knows, he has knowledge, and he knows that he knows. He knows that he's knowledgeable. This is a scholar, a person of knowledge, follow him. ورجل يعلم ولا يعلم أنه يعلم فذلك غافل فأيقظه. And a person who knows, he has the knowledge, but he is not aware that he has the knowledge. He doesn't know that he knows. So this is a person who's heedless. Wake him up. ورجل لا يعلم ويعلم أنه لا يعلم فذلك جاهل فعلمه. And a man who doesn't know, but he knows that he doesn't know. Simple ignorance, right? Lack of knowledge. A person who doesn't know, and he knows that he doesn't know, this is an ignorant, just teach him. Simple. You don't have it hard with people who lack knowledge. But the problem is people who lack knowledge, that's the fourth type. And then he says, وَرَجُلٌ لَا يَعْلَمْ وَلَا يَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُ لَا يَعْلَمْ. I forgot it. What he says, okay. لا يعلم ولا يعلم أنه لا يعلم. Anyway, so he gives him a description. Then he says, فاجتنبوه. So he says, a person who doesn't know, and he doesn't know that he doesn't know, so he thinks he knows. So he says, this is an evil person. Avoid him. Stay away from such people. Stay away from such people. So, with the Prophet ﷺ, going back, we took a long digression, let's come back. So the Prophet ﷺ, he simply says, I don't know how to read. I don't know how to read. When Jibreel came to him, he made it clear, I don't know. So if you have something, teach me. That's the attitude. And that's when the mind becomes absorbent. That's when you learn. That's when you don't have arguments with people. You find someone doing something and say, you know, it's not the way this is supposed to be done. And you're really speaking from knowledge yourself. So you're not the person who doesn't know and doesn't know that he doesn't know, but you think you know and you start teaching people, that's a problem. But you actually know exactly what you're talking about, you advise someone, and he just simply says, oh, I don't know about this. Thank you for teaching me. I really appreciate this. Thanks. But if he's the fourth type, they say, no, I know this. I just read this, or I know, I don't need you to teach me. That shows that's the fourth type of person, that who's ignorant about himself as well. So the Prophet ﷺ himself, he was, for him, I don't know how to read. So Jibreel alayhi salam says, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read in the name of your Lord who created. These are profound words. Just look at them, try to absorb them deeply. So the way for you is reading, learning, knowledge. That's the only way forward. That's the only way to paradise. You need to learn. This is why the Prophet ﷺ says, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. Seeking knowledge is an obligation on every Muslim. Every Muslim has to seek knowledge. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. In the name of your Lord who created. Because reading will not be beneficial unless it's done in the name of your Lord, for the sake of your Lord, and under the guidance of your Lord. Without that, reading could work against you. Reading could work against you. I just read about a study yesterday. They looked into people who are atheist and people who are religious, and they found people who are atheists, they said they are lost in critical thinking. These people think about their thinking as well. They keep thinking and thinking and thinking about this, and they question their thinking, and they keep questioning. They're sort of lost in their thinking. They're sort of lost. So it's excessive. It's more of an obsessive kind of critical thinking. So this is why one side of their brain, which is the left, the critical mind, overworks, whereas the right mind, which is more of an intuitive, more of an inspiration type of mind, for them is mainly idle. So it's an imbalanced way of thinking. So it's only with the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that your reading and your thinking and your learning actually could lead you to the truth. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. The one who created. That means the one who originated. So this whole existence came through Allah. Allah created, brought that into existence. He's the originator. He's the source of being. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. So all the reading you're doing, it all comes from who? From the one who originated. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. خلق الإنسان من علق. He created man from a clot. He created man from that small piece of clot. That's what man was created from. So that shows, look at the greatness of your Lord. That small clot turned into this human being, this profound, complex human being. Today as well, I was just listening to something. One of the leading psychologists in the world, he's actually here in Toronto. His name is Jordan Peterson. I think he's in the University of Toronto. He says, human beings are like are multi-level beings. He says they are amazing in the sense that a human being can have multiple personalities, the same person. You can have many facets in your life. This complex being was just a blood clot. Blood clot. And it was even more simple than that. It was much more simple than that. That shows the greatness of Allah's creation. خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم. Read. Again, an emphasis on the process of learning and reading. اقرأ وربك الأكرم. And your Lord is the most noble, is the most generous. And it shows that you want the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, reading is one of the best ways. Learning is one of the best ways. You get the treasures from Allah. And that means in this world and in the hereafter. اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم. Allah taught through the pen. Because we know the first thing that Allah created in the universe is the pen. The first creation Allah ever created. The first creation. There was only Allah. At some point, there was only Allah. The first thing Allah created was القلم, the pen. فَقَالَ لَهُ اكْتُبْ فَكَتَبَ مَا هُوَ كَائِنٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. So Allah told the pen, write, and the pen wrote down everything that was going to happen from that moment till the day of judgment. Everything. Everything in what sense? Even things you cannot think about. Even talking about physical bodies, talking about this bottle being here at this moment in time today, it was written by that pen at that time, 50,000 years before the creation of the heavens and the earth. And not only this, you know the molecules, water molecules in this bottle as well, each one, its destiny was written beforehand, how it was going to unfold before it became a reality. And that shows you the power of the word. Everything before it became a reality, it was a word. It was a word in the records of Allah. That shows you the power of the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the word of Allah has the power to say just be, and it becomes a reality, and it is. It's so powerful. Why isn't the Quran having this impact on us? Because we're not opening up to it. Because these are the words of Allah as well. So that shows you the power of the word. The power of the word, that everything before it became a reality, it was first a word that was written by the pen that Allah first created. So, الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ. Then the pen became more of a tool as well that we took to read and write, learn how to read and write and document and so on and so forth. And we say pen, don't be only limited to that physical pen that you know. Even when you're typing, that follows from the same principle. Same thing, that's writing at the end of the day. So within the general frame of a pen, that all falls under the pen. And one of the signs of the hereafter, the Prophet ﷺ said, وَيَفْشُ الْقَلَمُ. The Prophet ﷺ said, and writing will be so widespread and profuse that almost everyone is writing. Everyone writes, everyone produces. And it seems to be happening, but we don't know how far it can go. It could go even much more. Everyone is writing emails almost on a daily basis. A lot of people are blogging. A lot of people are documenting. People are writing minutes of meetings. Even whatever you say on your mobile phone is probably being written and scripted electronically, right? So, fushu al-qalam, writing, everything is being written and documented. So anyway, so these were the first words revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. So the Prophet ﷺ says, فَكَأَنَّمَا كُتِبَتْ فِي قَلْبِي كِتَابًا. As if these words were written in my heart. He absorbed them. Then he rushes to, who's his best friend? He goes to Khadija radiallahu anha, he explains to her. He rushes to Khadija and he's petrified. He's completely scared. He's freaked out. So he goes to Khadija radiallahu anha and he finds that calm and that peace that you find in that woman, that powerful woman. And he says to her, he tells her the story. He came to me and he told me to read and he helped me tight. And it was such a scary thing. You know, sometimes sometimes it happens that I'm late here in the masjid, I'm past midnight and I'm walking back home. And I see some shadow here or there and I'm really like, I freeze in my place and I feel my blood pressure going down and my heart is sinking. It's just seeing a shadow there. Imagine on top of a mountain by yourself and you see something you've never seen before. It's an angel. It's an angel as well. And all of these strange things. Imagine the Prophet ﷺ, how his like psychological state was. So he rushes to Khadija radiallahu anha. He tells her the story and he's obviously, you can imagine him breathing and being confused and worried and anxious. And she says to him, لا والله لا يخزيك الله أبدا. She says, Allah will never disgrace you. Calm down. It's okay. Everything's all right. Then, so she, I want to actually read her words because her words are very profound. So he comes to her and he says, Zammiluni, cover me. He's shaking and he's feeling cold. He's feeling cold. It's not cold, but he's feeling cold because of the fear. So he sits with her, حَتَّى ذَهَبَ عَنْهُ الرَّوْعُ. So he's with Khadija, in the presence of Khadija, until he calms down. So just being with Khadija calmed him down, radiallahu anha. Calmed the Prophet ﷺ down. And that shows as well, like sometimes your child comes to you or someone comes to you, you know, problem, you get even more confused, right? You cause them more anxiety. What happened? You think it's an emergency, you want to jump to acting before understanding what it was. But look at how a balanced person is. خديجة رضي الله عنها, it seems that he said, cover me, cover me. She just covered him and she let him calm down through her presence. Nothing. Then after he calmed down, he tells her the story. He tells her the story. And that's a very good way to deal with such situations. Sometimes when you get excited and agitated by someone who's already has already lost it, you just, you know, you exacerbate the situation, you make things worse. Because more tension doesn't solve the problem. It's usually because, you know, our senses are blocked, are halted. When we are confused, when we are scared, when we are angry, when we are aroused emotionally, we don't have our senses. We're in survival mode. It's fight, flight, right? Either fight or run away. So your mind shuts down. You don't think wisely. So then Prophet ﷺ tells her the story. Then he says to her, لَقَدْ خَشِيتُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِي. I'm scared for myself. Look at what his feelings are. I'm scared for myself. I'm scared for myself. فَقَالَتْ لَهُ خَدِيجَةُ كَلَّا وَاللَّهِ مَا يُخْزِيكَ اللَّهُ أَبَدًا. No, والله, Allah will never disgrace you. Allah will never treat you bad. إِنَّكَ لَتَصِلُ الرَّحِمِ. You observe the rights of your kin. You connect to your relatives. You give them your rights. You're very good. وَتَحْمِلُ الْكَلِّ. Someone is tired, overwhelmed, you help them out. وَتُكْسِبُ الْمَعْدُومِ. And someone who's completely penniless, has no money, you give them from your own money. وَتُقْرِ الضَّيْفِ. And you're very generous to you're very generous host to your guests. وَتُعِينُ عَلَىٰ نَوَائِبِ الْحَقِّ. And whenever anyone falls in trouble, you help them out. You get out of your way to go and help them. Then she takes the Prophet ﷺ to her cousin, Waraqa ibn Nawfal. Waraqa ibn Nawfal, we said he was tanassara fil jahiliyyah. He was upon one version of Christianity, which was closer to monotheism. So she goes to him, and he had knowledge of the scriptures, the Torah and the Gospels. So Waraqa says to him, what do you see? What happened? So the Prophet ﷺ told him the story. So Waraqa says to him, هذا الناموس الذي نزل على موسى. This is the angel that descended upon Musa عليه السلام. And the Arabs had knowledge about Musa. Why? Because there were Jews in Medina. So it was known. Musa عليه السلام was very well known among the Arabs. يا ليتني فيها جذعا. I wish that when you are commanded to share your message, that I was young, that I were young. ليتني أكون حيا إذ يخرجك قومك. I wish I'd be alive when you are commanded to share the message. فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أو مخرجية هم. The Prophet says, are they gonna kick me out? Like my people are gonna kick me out? Like he says, I wish I'm alive when your people kick you out. Now this seems to be out of context. The Prophet says, my people are gonna kick me out, and this is, you know, it's difficult to swallow. Like, especially the Arabs had this patriotism, this nationalism about them, this tribalism. They would not let down any of their members. They would protect each other. They would die for that, because it's a matter of honor. So the Prophet says, my people are going to kick me out? Like, gonna, you know, let go of me, you know, let me down and push me out of my place? So Waraqa said, yes. لم يأتي رجل بمثل ما جئت به إلا عودي. No man came with whatever you're coming with except that he incurred enmity from his people. وإن يدركني يومك أنصرك نصرا مؤزرا. And if that day reaches me when I'm alive, I will have your back. I'll help you. I will support you. So that was the night that marked the birth of the truth again, the new birth of the truth. After the earth has been filled with darkness, now the Prophet ﷺ received the revelation. Now, this is the time the Prophet ﷺ, that's all what he's given. So the Prophet ﷺ, somehow at this moment, he understands what's going on, he realizes it's a message, it's the truth, it's about the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, it's the same that was sent to Moses and Isa alayhi salam. That's serious. My personal hunch is that Khadija had a very good feel of what was going on. Khadija رضي الله عنها seems she had a very good feel of what was going on, as she was actually anticipating that. She was expecting that. Because the whole way she handled the situation right from the early days of her relationship with the Prophet ﷺ shows that this, she had something. It was probably a hunch, maybe it was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just threw that in her heart, or maybe her knowledge from, that she took from her cousin as well, that she learned something about that. She was actually expecting or anticipating Muhammad ﷺ to be the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what we see now, the Prophet ﷺ was accepted by his wife Khadija, so she's the first one to be Muslim after him, and Waraqa ibn Nawfal. Now a few days after this moment, Waraqa ibn Nawfal dies. He passes. Waraqa ibn Nawfal. So the only so who's Muslim there? The Prophet sallallahu and Khadija. The Prophet sallallahu and Khadija. You know what happens at this time? It seems like, okay, this is quiet, it's just the Prophet ﷺ, only happening to him, his wife Khadija, Waraqa ibn Nawfal. But during that night, the whole world was in chaos, because the jinn were able to ascend to the closest heaven, the nearest heaven. And you know when Allah, as the Prophet ﷺ says in Sahih al-Bukhari, he says how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the angels. When Allah sends a command to the angels will hand it down from one to the other, one to the other, from the seventh heaven to the sixth, fifth, fourth, so on and so forth, until it reaches the lowest heaven where it is given the execution orders, where the angels who are supposed to do this, fulfill this command and order and carry it out, they are the ones who receive it finally, and then they go about doing it. So the Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith, and the Prophet ﷺ was talking actually about the verse in the Quran where Allah ﷻ says, قَالُوا مَاذَا قَالَ رَبُّكُمْ قَالُوا الْحَقَّ وَهُوَ الْعَلِيُّ الْكَبِيرُ. They said, the angels say to each other, what did Allah say? What was the command of Allah? They said it was the truth, and He is the Most High, and He is the Almighty. And then the angels would prostrate, and they would, the command will come to them, فَيَسْمَعُونَ مِثْلَ صَلْصَلَةِ السِّلْسِلَةِ عَلَى الصَّفَى. So they hear like the sound of a chain, you know, a metal chain, big metal chain thrown on a big stone. That kind of noise it makes, the metal rocking against the stone, that's how it sounds to the angels. And then they will interpret it to each other at that moment. That's when the jinn, and what we call يَسْتَرِقُونَ السَّمْعَ, they try to overhear, the jinn try to overhear, what is the command of Allah? So they take it, they grab part of it, they hear some of it, they rush down to the sorcerers, the people who deal with black magic, deal with the jinn, and they tell them this such and such is going to happen. So this is why some people, yes, they would have some insight into the unseen during those times. Where did they get it from? From dealing with the jinn. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this in the Quran, the Prophet ﷺ explained it in the hadith. But the moment the Prophet ﷺ received the revelation, what happened? There was a shield. There was a shield put to protect the heavens from the jinn. So the jinn, if they approached the heaven, they would be hit with a shooting star. So they could not. And this is what Surah Al-Jinn talks about. This is what Surah Al-Jinn explains, especially the first page of it. It explains exactly the state of the jinn. وَأَنَّا كُنَّا نَقْعُدُ مِنْهَا مَقَاعِدَ لِلسَّمْعِ فَمَنْ يَسْتَمِعِ الْآنَ يَجِدْ لَهُ شِهَابًا بَصَدًا. We used to have seats close to the heavens to overhear what the commands that were given to the angels were, and we would grab them and take them. فَمَنْ يَسْتَمِعِ الْآنَ يَجِدْ لَهُ شِهَابًا بَصَدًا. Whoever tries to hear now, then they will be shot with a shooting star. وَأَنَّا لَا نَدْرِي أَشَرٌ أُرِيدَ بِمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ أَمْ أَرَادَ بِهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ رَشَدًا. We don't know what is planned for the people on earth. Is it good or is it bad? Is it their destruction or is it something good for them? So there was chaos going on. The angels were in a state of mess. And even one narration in Sahih al-Bukhari, Shaytan was confused himself, because the shayateen came to him and they said, we can't hear anymore, we can't do it, we seem to be controlled, there's so much limitations. And he says, إِنَّ هَذَا لَأَمْرٌ جَلَلٌ. Something big is happening. Something big is happening. So he sends the shayateen all over the earth to find out what was happening. Until one person comes to him with the news and he says, that's it. That said, the Prophet was sent. Final Prophet was sent. So when the Prophet ﷺ was sent, the shayateen could not hear anything. And this is why Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, and this narration is in Sahih Muslim, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he says, and that's he remembers now. Now we're shifting forward and moving forward in time. When Umar is a Muslim, he actually mentions something that he remembers from his days before Islam. He says, بينما أنا يوما في السوق. Yes. So there is a sorcerer, a female sorcerer, a witch. Umar al-Khattab knew her. She was in Mecca. So he says, بينما أنا يوما في السوق جاءتني أعرف فيها الفزع فقالت. He says, I was one day in the market in Mecca, and I saw this witch, or this female sorcerer. I saw her coming, and she was frightened. I can see that the fear in her eyes. And then she says, أَلَمْ تَرَى الْجِنَّ وَإِبْلَاسَهَا وَيَأْسَهَا بَعْدَ إِنْكَاسِهَا وَلُحُوقَهَا بِالْقِلَاصِ وَأَحْلَاسِهَا. He says, don't you see at the jinn and how they've been subdued and how they are now in a state of despair and loss. And now they're trying to chase after the camels, basically chasing after the camels to find out news. So فَقَالَ عُمَرْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ صدق فبينما أنا عند آلهتهم إذ جاء رجل بعجل فذبحه فصرخ به صارخ لم أسمع صارخا أشد قط أشد صوتا منه. So Umar al-Khattab says that was true, because when I was there, which is near the Kaaba where the idols were, he says a man came and he brought a ram and he slaughtered that ram for the idols as an idol worship, as a sacrifice. Then when he did that, there was a very sharp scream that says, and Umar al-Khattab says, I've never heard a scream as loud as this. And it says, Ya Jalih, Amrun Najih, Rajulun Fasih, Yaqulu La Ilaha Illallah. Basically, Ya Jalih, it's a name. It's calling upon someone called Jalih. Amrun Najih, a successful affair, something that is bound to succeed. A very eloquent man. He would say, La ilaha illallah. So people were in a state of confusion in Mecca. فَقُلْتُ لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَعْلَمَ مَا وَرَاءَ هَذَا. So Umar said, I'm gonna find out what's going on behind, what's the story behind this. So he said, I kept searching and searching. Then shortly after, we started to hear that someone was claiming to be a prophet in Mecca. Someone was claiming to be a prophet in Mecca. As I said, this narration is in Sahih, actually in Sahih al-Bukhari. It's in Sahih al-Bukhari. Okay. So that was the first night with the Prophet ﷺ and with Jibreel alayhi salam. What happened? The Prophet ﷺ has calmed down. He realizes it's about messengership now. It's about being a prophet, being a messenger. It's about warning people. So the Prophet ﷺ is expecting Jibreel to come to him again. Probably he went back to the cave, sometimes in his house. Jibreel is not coming. The Prophet ﷺ is waiting. Expecting, like, he came the first time, such a very powerful stance, and now the Prophet ﷺ is expecting more. So first week passes, nothing. Second week passes, nothing. First month, nothing. You can imagine how desperate the Prophet ﷺ was. He was looking forward to what's going to happen next. Second month passes, nothing. Third month passes, nothing. 6 months pass, nothing. Imagine the state of the Prophet ﷺ. A year passes, nothing. 2 years pass, nothing. 3 years pass, almost 3 years and nothing. Then Jibreel comes back to the Prophet ﷺ. This is something many people don't know. There is an argument among the scholars as to how long this period was. And the strongest opinion fluctuate between 2 years, 2.5 years to 3 years. They call it Fatratul Wahi. Okay? With the time when the revelation on the Prophet ﷺ halted, that was directly after the first revelation. Directly after the first revelation. So the Prophet ﷺ would go to the mountains, you know, trying to, hopefully Jibreel would come. Hopefully something would happen. But nothing would happen. But here's something that we have to keep in mind, okay? This narration is in Sahih al-Bukhari. The Prophet ﷺ would go on top of mountains, and obviously because Jibreel came to him when he was on the mountain. So he's expecting Jibreel to come, so he's trying to be in that context, so hopefully Jibreel would come. And that's when the narration ends. There is something that we call idraj. This is in the science of hadith, hadith al-mudraj. Hadith al-mudraj is when one of the narrators of the hadith, like, okay, this hadith is reported by Aisha radiallahu anha, and one of the tabi'een, Az-Zuhri, narrates it from Aisha. Let's say, okay, there's another one between Aisha and Az-Zuhri, someone narrates it from Aisha, then Az-Zuhri narrates it, and so on and so forth. Az-Zuhri added a commentary on this hadith, and he said, فِيمَا بَلَغَنَا. Okay, it's called بَلَغَاتُ الزُّهْرِ in the science of hadith. So he says, that's a speculation. Some people thought, as Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani says in his commentary on Sahih Bukhari, he says, some of the narrators of the hadith thought that the Prophet was very desperate, that he probably was thinking of throwing himself off the mountains. But there's nothing like this in the hadith. There's nothing like this in the hadith. It's just speculation by some of the narrators. And this is why Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, actually, when he said about these things, he said these are not part of the hadith. And he somehow slightly like showed disagreement to that kind of statement. This is what some of the Orientalists took, and they said, they tried to discredit the Prophet ﷺ, and they say he tried to commit suicide. But there's nothing like this. There's speculation by one of the narrators of the hadith, and it was rejected by many scholars of hadith throughout the times. So just keep this in mind. So 3 years, no revelation after the first one. So what happens after these 3 years? It's a very beautiful meeting this time. Imagine the Prophet is waiting for 3 years, and now Jibreel comes to him after 3 years. But there was something happening during these 3 years, by the way. And it's very interesting, and it kept the Prophet patient. We'll find out next week, inshallah. طيب, so the halaqa will be after Maghrib. Jazakum Allah khairan. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.